and gentlemen, welcome. Good evening. My name is Tracy George, and it is with great pride and humility that I stand before you this evening as we pay tribute to one of our island's greatest sons, Sir Derek Alton Walcott. In the Paris Review interview, Sir Derek says that he was absolutely a Caribbean poet who longed for the company of better Caribbean poets. This evening, we have the fulfillment of his dream. Gathered here tonight to pay homage to him are some of the finest local, regional, and international artists. Sir Derek considered himself at the beginning rather than at the end of a tradition of cultural greatness, and tonight promises to demonstrate that greatness. We now invite Her Excellency Dame Pearlette Louisy, the Governor General of Saint Lucia, and the Chair of the Nobel Laureate Festival Committee with the welcome remarks.
In fact, when I drove up this evening and I saw all the vehicles and the numbers streaming, and I said, oh, where are these people when I have the Derek Walcott lecture? But I am glad that you've come, and we couldn't do any less for Sir Derek. I was really asked, if I recall, to pay a small tribute to Sir Derek in my capacity as chair of the Nobel Laureate Week Committee. So I'll do that in the 3 minutes I was allotted. Our national celebration of our Nobel laureate, Sir Derek Walcott, began in January 1993, 2 months after this long-awaited announcement reached the four corners of the globe. Saint Lucia now had its second Nobel laureate, an amazing feat for a country of our size. As the years went by, the celebration grew from Nobel Laureate Day to Nobel Laureate Week, and this year to the Nobel Laureate Festival, spanning almost 3 weeks. The aim of the celebrations has always been twofold. First, the honoring of the achievements of our two laureates, and secondly, the showcasing of the work and contribution of our nationals across the board in every sphere of endeavor. And in fact, our theme has been, over the years, celebrating excellence. After all, we reasoned there might just be another laureate or two in our midst, just waiting to be called. From the very beginning, the Derek Walcott Lecture has been a staple of the program of activities. The presenters have come from among us, from the region, and far, far beyond our shores. We welcome those from that impressive list who have come back to pay their last respects. The St. Lucia Nobel Laureate Committee, in collaboration with both public and private sector agencies and organizations, has always considered it an honor to be in the vanguard of programs, projects, and activities to celebrate the man, his life, and his work. It is our fervent hope that his passing will not diminish our efforts to honor his achievements and to show our appreciation in very tangible ways for his exceptional contribution to the literary, artistic, and cultural legacy of St. Lucia, the Caribbean, and the world. For us, Sir Derek will always be a beacon of excellence. We will continue to follow that guiding light, beckoning us to continue to celebrate his work just as we did while he lived among us. And if indeed you think one of these days or in the days to come that you just saw him in that, and I quote, neglected inlet, or in that green funny hole by the road in the mountain over there, do not be alarmed, for he will always be with us, having promised not to leave his home until he and his fellow artists had put it all down in words and paint. He will be with us for a while, because you will agree that there is still a lot of writing and painting to be done, and a lot of mentoring and teaching and guiding to be offered. So he's around, and you'll be seeing him. And just again, let me, you know, just tell you, don't, well, it wouldn't be, you know, a Sukuyan or any of those things. It will just be Sir Derek in every little corner of St. Lucia, because that's what his life's work was. We saw the beauty of our country through his eyes. And so we'll be seeing him everywhere we turn. In Theopolis Hound, he taught us what should be true of the remembered life. And it is what he calls the freshness of detail. This is how it was. Let us therefore remember Sir Derek how he was. The St. Lucia Nobel Laureate Committee joins our nation and the world in celebrating the life of one of the world's greatest poets. So, ladies and gentlemen, let us celebrate Sir Derek's life. Let us not forget him.
And as Derek once said, I have never separated the writing of poetry from prayer. I have grown up believing it is a vocation, a religious vocation. And with that said, I welcome Monsignor Patrick Anthony with the prayers for this evening.
Tout ça nous ni, c'est bon Dieu qui ban nous. Tout ça nous fait, c'est lui nous qui a bay plaisir. Thank you, Father, for this wonderful gift of our nation, our people, your son, Derek. Fill our hearts with this bounty, this sense of gratitude for all that you have and continue to give us. We say thank you, Father. Nukaru Papa, merci, merci. And we join the manner in which we've all prayed so often. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Derek says, I think the African influence is in the melody of my voice. I think it's there that you can find the music. Certainly, in the plays, it's very strong because it's a society of percussion. And with that, we now have La Pocabuit with a drumming performance.
Thank you. Sir Derek Walcott graduated from the University of the West Indies with a Bachelor of Arts degree in 1953. 20 years later, he was awarded an Honorary Doctor of Letters degree. The Honorary Doctorate is a university's highest honor and is awarded to someone who has made outstanding contributions to and sterling representation of his society at home and abroad. No one can dispute the fact that Sir Derek Walcott did this at a level far beyond the reach of our collective imagination. And the UWI is proud to have been instrumental in nurturing his early development as a poet and playwright. In fact, we like to think of his scholarly genius flourishing under the stately pui trees on our beautiful Mona campus in Jamaica, in the shadow of the legendary Blue Mountains, as that phenomenal mind churned out poetic language with unparalleled mastery. Sir Derek's legacy lives on at the UWI through a scholarship which was established in his name for students enrolled in the theater arts program at the St. Augustine campus. However, we can also point to a more personal legacy to our institution in the form of his daughters. Professor Elizabeth Walcott Hackshaw, who heads the Department of Modern Languages and Linguistics at St. Augustine, and Ms. Anna Walcott Hardy, who served the university for many years as communications manager and also editor-in-chief of the campus news magazine. UWI Vice Chancellor Sir Hilary Beckles aptly described Sir Derek as one of the finest intellects of the 20th century, a literary phenomenon. Much of Walcott's work is imbued with the ethos of a people brought together by historical forces. It documents the way in which we have forged through pain and suffering, laughter and hope, that Caribbean persona which is like no other. Sir Derek was never constrained by artificial boundaries. He was a world figure. Nevertheless, no matter how far his intellectual wanderings took him, he always returned to the Caribbean, and in particular, the landscape of his beloved Saint Lucia. It pained him, though, to see how many had lost their way, embracing greed and destruction of the beauty of a land which even the great laureate could never find enough words to describe. In White Egrets, he mourned the doomed acres where yet another luxury hotel will be built with ordinary people fenced out. And he decried a policy that will make the island a mall, perpetuating a slavery without chains. Whether those doomed acres are at Pigeon Island, Sandy Beach, Kwale, or Sabwisha, the pain which poured from his pen is palpable. Sir Derek was also very concerned about the disappearance of literature from our schools and the corresponding rise of insensibility, of disregard for what is beautiful and what is spiritually sustaining. I recall how excited he was when the UWE Open Campus introduced a creative writing course for young writers. At my last meeting with him, and Sigrid, you will remember that, although he was obviously weakening, he expressed his commitment to doing some guest lectures for this course. But he insisted that we put on Shakespeare's King Lear as one of the required texts. Catherine Atkinson and I tried in vain to explain to him that this might scare the beginning writers, but he waved us away at saying dismissively, "No one should be doing a creative writing course without doing King Lear. We must start with King Lear." We also discussed putting on a series of masterclass lectures which would have been held at the Walcott House this semester. He thought that this would be a wonderful way of making the Walcott House a living museum. But alas, despite his most valiant intentions, it was not to be. Sir Derek was the true embodiment of the motto of our university, Oriens ex occidente lux, a light rising from the west. He rose from among us, a people battered, bruised, brutally colonized, and he shone on a world stage, creating a space for those who followed him and made his work their beacon. Sir Derek certainly kept the promise that he and Sir Dunstan St. Omer had made, and to which he refers in another life. They swore that we would never leave the island until we had put down in paint, in words, all of its sunken, leaf-choked ravines and every neglected, self-pitying inlet. It was as if he had envisaged the relentless Philistinian assault on our fair island, and he sought, through the immortality of metaphor, to leave us the gift of memory at the very least. For the sake of our children, I hope that we will be left with more than metaphor to mark the uniqueness of our country. Having left us his heart and soul embodied in his writing, Sir Derek's light, like that of his alma mater university, will never be dimmed. Those of us who truly love this land must use his passion to light our own way in making the right decisions for our and Derek's beloved Saint Lucia. The University of the West Indies administration, students, and staff join Sir Derek's family and friends in mourning this great loss and in celebrating this great life as we seek peace and comfort in the volume of work that he has left behind. Light and blessings to you all, and may he rest in peace.
I first met Derek in 1992. After he'd won his Nobel Prize and he came back to Trinidad to revive a lot of his work at the theater workshop, and I was one of the young guns that had the privilege to get the opportunity to do his work, and I am eternally grateful and thankful. And I say Derek's genius was matched only by his generosity, certainly to me and to a whole generation of younger players. The first play that I got a chance to do was Dream on Monkey Mountain. And I'd like to do a little piece from that. Not the part that I played, but Macaque. a part that was played by Errol Jones. And I remember being on stage with him in Rotterdam and completely forgetting my lines because I was so mesmerized by his acting. So I'll try my best. Please. I remember one day when I was younger, 50 years old or so, I wake up alone and I do not know myself. I wake up an old man that morning with my clothes stinking of 50 years of sweat, my eye closing with gum, my two hands trembling, trembling when I open them so. And I look in them with all the marks like rivers, like a dead tree. And I ask myself in a voice I do not know, who you are, Neg? I say to the voice and to my hands, with the black coal in the cuts, I say, your name is what? An older man without a mirror. And I went in little rain barrel behind my hut and looked down in the quiet, quiet water at my face, an old, cracked, burn-up face with the hair turning white. And it was macaque. So I say, if you're dead now, well, what? No woman will cry for you. No child will look at your face in debt as if it was the first time. The water in the rain barrel will show the cloud changing, and as it have no memory, will forget your face. It will show the hawk passing, smaller than a fly, and it will lick a dead leaf with its tongue. But you will go under this earth and burn and change as if you are coal yourself, Charbonnet. A big, big loneliness possessed me, as if I was happy once and strong, but could not remember where. As if, in some way, I was not no charcoal burner. God be blessed. But a king, and I feel strongly to go down that mountain and to reach the sea, as if the place I remember was across the sea. Lord, I have been washed from shore to shore as a tree in the ocean. The branches of my fingers, the roots of my feet could grip nothing. But now, God, they have found ground. Let me be swallowed up in mist again, and let me be forgotten, so that when the mist opened, men could look up at a small hut in a clearing and a small signal of smoke and say, macaque lives there. Macaque lives where he has always lived, in the dream of his people. Other men will come, other prophets will come, and they will be beaten and stoned and betrayed. But at last, this old hermit is going back home. Back to the beginning, to the green beginnings of this world. Come, Moustique, we're going home. I going home, I going home. I going home, I going home. I going home, I going home to my father's kingdom. No more sorrow, no more pain. No more sorrow, no more pain. No more sorrow, no more pain in my Father's kingdom. I go in home, I go in home, I go in home. I go in home, I go in home. I go in home, I go in home to my Father's kingdom.
Merci, Eddie Quick. Merci, Eddie Quick. This is lave time. Makak no charcoal burner, but a king. I bring in greetings from the folklorists center. Because it is at the folklorists center that Derek found an oasis of hope. What he wanted to do, to make fishermen and foresters heraldic men. That's what he has done. Made Timamai, Saint Lucia, children of the Caribbean. Epic, world class, phenomenal. And so we bring you greetings tonight from the splendor of our achievements, where Derek has brought us. We say to you, let us not grieve. Paple way by Derek. Paple way by moi. La moi libe way. L'esprit. Libewe, Dishene, let's be leave. Oh, little red bird in your cage of rib, tremble, tremble. Ah. The sky has no gate. The open air is your temple. This is why we bring you greetings tonight, not condolences, greetings as we celebrate. In 1976, Derek published Sea Grapes. And the central poem of Sea Grapes called Saint Lucia, the third part, there's a poem called Ayona Mabuya Valley. It is all Creole. Well, not really. It was Derek's attempt at Creole. And in fact, the lexicon was all French. Until he encountered things like Bon Dieu Kai Benou. And what did he write? Bon Dieu. And then he stuck. So he put Kai, K-A-I. Benir, B-E-N-I-R, apostrophe O-U-S. So Benirus. You see, there was no orthography. There was no writing system. And so Harry had attempted earlier on to find some way to capture the language of the people. As Derek sought to capture that language, but he struggled. This is why the folklorists center was for him an oasis. Because we did not only plumb the depths of the St. Lucian culture and creativity, we were able, with persons like those involved in National Research Foundation, to come up with an orthography, a writing system, so that today we can say, we can rewrite Iona with an established orthography. The folklorists center celebrates those who helped to form the minds of Derek and Roddy and Dunstan. We have a Harold Simmons Folk Academy. It is a place where we are celebrating St. Lucia, where we are celebrating what Derek discovered. I spoke with Eric Branford, to whom Iona has been dedicated. And I told him, Eric, Derek dedicated that poem to you. Yes, Eric Branford. He said, Baba, you know, I used to be working at PHEU. And in those days, I had the truck. And so, in my work, I used to go all around the country. And Harry would jump at the back, and Roddy and Derek. and Spa on his BSA bike would follow. And there they would go. He told me how. You know how we discovered Sesen? It was on those trips. One day we were coming from Viewfort and we went by Grace Augustine. And Grace Augustine said, there is a young lady who sings so beautifully. And she called Sesen and Sesen came out. And when Derek and Dan Crowley heard Sesen, no wonder he loved Sesen so much. My country heart is never home till Sesen sings, he says. This is why he loves so much Papius and them when they're playing. Si me douce, fais moi la peine, me ouisa. Ah, yes. This is why tonight we celebrate. And in the name of the Folklorists Center, we say, Derek, you live on, brother. Your spirit continues to lift up this nation. You have brought us to the pinnacle. The world gazes at us tonight. Thank you. We shall not let you down. We shall continue. As John Robert Lee says, for ours is an HS line. Thank you.
If in the light of things you fade, real yet wanly withdrawn to our determined and appropriate distance, like the moon left on all night among the leaves, may you invisibly delight this house, O star, doubly compassionate, who came too soon for twilight, too late for dawn. May your pale flame direct the worst in us through chaos with the passion of plain day.
Labor, Debo, Ibo.
It is no small honor to be asked sometimes to speak on behalf of a friend, be it at a wedding, the courthouse, or even at a funeral. You progress with alacrity to infuse the mortal coil with power and purpose beyond capacity of its humble, fragile human sinews, living or dead, glowing, of course, in the end when you receive the traditional pat on the back for a job well done. But when that mortal frame once belonged to a living legend who has eclipsed into immortality, what can you say? What can one write that has not been written before at least once? This is the predicament in which I find myself, standing before you, trying to weave my magic in 5 minutes without a wand, or with the dexterity of a G.K. Rowling's. What can I talk about that has not been said in his honest, simple voice, or have not already been uttered by others in glowing superlatives? A great poet does not happen like a freak of nature. Nothing is by chance. First comes that deep love which breeds the fragility of humanism, manifesting as a love of country and deep-rooted sense of belonging, becoming one with the earth wrapped in mankind's enduring embrace. A phenomenal faith grounded in sincerity and truth. There is the loneliness and the isolation that brings tears when moments grip the nerve and the urge to encapsulate the second and store it for posterity on a page reverberates on the mind. Simply put, he loved his country, St. Lucia, and its people beyond reproach, down to the last grain of dust, rising with a hot wind in Lent on an unpaved country road. He loved the smell of the Creole bread rising with morning from a baker's oven, or etherized by the joy suffused in an old woman's toothless grin. Moïse Jean Saint Lucie, c'est la moissotie. He sings in his local vernacular. Of him it could be truly said, as he said of Harry in another life, his island forests open and enclose him like a rare butterfly between its leaves. Armed with a simple gift to see beyond the horizon of mortality into the heart of ordinary things, so that paradise once lost could be regained. Now he walks again with his mother Alex, his sister Pam, twin brother Roddy, and with the brotherhood of poets, Seamus and Joseph, Martin and Eric, Césaire and Saint-Jean Pierce. I can imagine him calling for a typewriter, paper, and fresh ribbons the minute he landed. His name, now permanently carved in legend, should not be honored in sadness with the usual parody of tears, but in tribute to his memory, imagine the driven gull finally coming to rest on the gommier log, waiting for an adze to shape it into the long canoe that will take him on a journey to wherever all poets go. To Sigrid, Peter, Lizzie, Anna, and his nephew Nigel, it will be hard for you in the beginning to balance between a companion, father, uncle, and the larger-than-life symbol of all humanity that he was. The pain of absence sears the mind, I know that well. But in time you will find consolation knowing that he lives on in his pages, the leaves of that monumental edifice he built with his two blessed hands over the short span of 7 decades, and that will endure the whips of time for and will be with us beyond our own humble years. There will be many equals, similar to William Shakespeare in the English language, but Derek Walcott has no duplicate. I extend my deepest condolences and that of the literary and theater community in St. Lucia to Derek's family and his large circle of friends from far and near. We will all miss him and the offbeat jokes and his infectious laughter that always made you laugh in spite of the jokes. I end abruptly, respecting the constraints of time, with a quote from Omarus that typifies his monumental genius and his love for all mankind. Because rhyme remains the parenthesis of palms, shielding a candle's tongue it is the language's desire to enclose the love world in its arms. I thank you. Thank you.
white stockings, a black child stands. First her, then a small field of her. Ah, it's first communion. They hold pink thistles in their hands, the stiff plaits pinned with their white satin muffs.
The caterpillar's accordion, still pumping out the myth along twigs of cotton, from whose parted mouths the wafer pods in the leaf without an if.
So, all across Saint Lucia, thousands of innocent were arranged on church steps, facing the sun's lens, erect as candles between squinting parents before night came, like their blinded saints.
But if it were possible to pull up on the verge of a dimming asphalt before its headlights lance their eyes, to house each child in my hands, to lower the window a crack, and delicately urge the last lock delicately in.
And let the dark car enclose their blizzard, and on some black hill,
their pulsing wings undusted, loose them in thousands, stagger heavenward before it came on.
The prejudice, the evil.
Write my name, write my name up there. If it touch my finger on the golden pen, golden pen, if it touch my finger on the golden pen and write my name up there. The sea is history. Where are your monuments, your battles, martyrs? Where's your tribal memory? Sirs, in that gray vault, the sea has locked them up. The sea is history. First, there was the heaving oil, heavy as chaos, then like a light at the end of a tunnel, the lantern of a caravel, and that was Genesis. Then there were the packed cries, the shit, the mourning, Exodus, bone soldered by coral to bone, mosaics mantled by the benediction of the shark's shadow. That was the Ark of the Covenant. Then came from the plucked wires of sunlight on the seafloor the plangent harp of the Babylonian bondage as the wide quarries clustered like manacles on the drowned women. And those were the ivory bracelets of the Song of Solomon. But the ocean kept turning blank pages, looking for history. Then came the men with eyes heavy as anchors who sank without tombs, brigands who barbecued cattle, leaving their charred ribs like palm leaves on the shore. Then the foaming, rabid maw of the tidal wave swallowing Port Royal. That was Jonah. But where is your Renaissance? Sir, it is locked in them sea sands out there past the reef's moiling shelf where the man o' war floated down. Strap on these goggles, I'll guide you there myself. It's all subtle and submarine through colonnades of coral past the gothic windows of sea fans to where the crusty grouper onyx-eyed blinks, weighted by its jewels like a bald queen. And these groined caves with barnacles pitted like stone are our cathedrals, and the furnace before the hurricane Gomorrah, bones ground by windmills into marl and cornmeal, and that was Lamentations. That was just lamentations, but it was not history. Then came, like scum on the river's drying lip, the brown reeds of villages mantling and congealing into towns, and at evening, the midges' choirs, and above them, the spires lancing the side of God as his sun set, and that was the New Testament. Then came the white sisters, clapping to the wave's progress, and that was emancipation, jubilation, oh jubilation, vanishing swiftly as the sea's lace dries in the sun. But that was not history, that was only faith. And then each rock broke into its own nation. Then came the synod of flies, then came the secretarial heron, then came the bullfrog bellowing for a vote, fireflies with bright ideas and bats like jetting ambassadors, and the mantis like khaki police, and the furred caterpillars of judges examining each case closely. And then in the dark airs of ferns and in the salt chuckle of rocks with their sea pools, there was the sound like a rumor without any echo of history really, really beginning. For Derek Walcott, for no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ, and so through him the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. Paul, 2 Corinthians 1:20. In the black box, the lights isolate emotion with theatrical efficiency. Every gesture is art, as if in the clean rehearsed moments, the word as the beginning of all things and glorious yes of possibility must be followed by the congregant saying, amen. This is the holy theater, a world I have come to think of as a home place, a shelter, the womb of my art. So there in that black box, deep inside a winter storm in Providence, they tell me the old man has slipped into his first sleep, and his editor calls, they say, to listen to the soft ebb and flow of the sea in his breathing. No one wants to say all is silence now, but we do know that after the poem is over, what remains is a soft pulse of the sea where we, the macaques of history, find our cathedrals, our history, our glorious tomb. I do not expect the thickening pain in my throat as if I could fall down and weep. I did not expect the moment to be like this, but it was, and here in the beginning of our lamentation, here is the beginning of all lamentation. For weeks I've carried in my head the calculation of greatness, how ambitious was the madman Lowell, how full of the privilege of his New England elitism, how it is that every time I think of the Boston police coming to secure him and carry him to another dark asylum, I can only think that I envy him the dignity they afforded him. And I think that the Saint Lucian would have known that five white Boston cops would not sit at his breakfast table while he shivered and ranted and read from The Sea is History before deporting him to the asylum of fire and healing. This is the way history arrests ambition. We migrants stay sane so that we can live to go mad in our secret chambers, but the old man has slipped into his first sleep, and at last all his promises of last poems, last words, last testaments seem fulfilled. This is not yet an elegy, merely an effort to clear the glue in my throat and a way of saying that his art comes to me burnished with so many grand yeses. And on this morning of great chill, I have learned to pray for language just enough to offer a word of company for the old man. And the word is waves, not original surely, but I offer it, the sea, the soft waves reaching the coast, the pulling back, the soft snore of a man waiting to leave the shore at last. I bring greetings from Calabash in Jamaica, from Justine Hensel, from my friend Elizabeth Alexander, from People Tree Books, an army of poets who continue to be tutored by Derek Walcott. We offer condolences, we offer strength, and we offer love. O world, O world, a world that we have lost. Thank you.
It is indeed an honor to read to you a tribute to Nobel laureate Sir Derek Walcott on behalf of the Right Honorable Patricia Scotland, Queen's Counsel, our Commonwealth General Secretary. There is something about Sir Derek Walcott's poetry the wind ruffling the tawny pelt and the strands of an ancient pastoral in those shires of the island where cattle drank their pools of shadow from the older sky, or the soft scissored foam as the deck turned white and the moon opened a cloud like a door. Growing up in the United Kingdom, there were many occasions when this powerful imagery transported me instantly back to my land of birth. To behold the scenery that must have inspired his words. And as I defined my own identity, he reminded me that the time will come when, with elation, you will greet yourself arriving at your own door. And in your own mirror, each will smile at the other's welcome and say, sit here, eat. I have had the pleasure of meeting Sir Derek Walcott only once in person, but his poems have had a lasting impact on me. And I was deeply saddened to learn of the death of this bright Commonwealth star. And though he has slipped beyond our reach, his profound wisdom, his brilliance, and his inspiration to pursue greatness are immortalized in the lines of powerful poetry like Omeros, which captured the essence of the Caribbean and stirred the hearts of minds and people around the globe. Born in a small Caribbean island, his ingenuity, vision, and passion for excellence propelled him into the spotlight of the world stage and earn him the glittering honor of a Nobel Prize. Again and again, I saw Sir Derek fearlessly addressing the issue of Caribbean identity and challenging the stereotypes and skewed perceptions that separate us all. He once referred to the Earth as an island of archipelagos in the stars. So for me, his greatest legacy is the knowledge that wherever we are born, in a developed or developing country, in a vast continent, or on a small Caribbean island, we all have the potential for greatness. This is why I would like to join the government and people of Saint Lucia today to honor their son and to celebrate his life and the immense contribution he has made to literature. For my country, Dominica, and Saint Lucia are inextricably linked by our history, our language, culture, kingship, topography. We are truly sisters. In many ways, Sir Derek felt as if he belonged a little to all of us. We will really miss his light. As a poet, I would now like to read one of my favorite poetry that made me fall in love with Sir Derek Walcott, Love After Love. The time will come when, with elation, you will greet yourself arriving at your own door, in your own mirror, and each will smile at the other's welcome and say, sit here, eat. You will love again the stranger who was yourself. Give wine, give bread, give back your heart to itself, to the stranger who has loved you all your life, whom you ignored for another, who knows you by heart. Take down the love letters from the bookshelf, the photographs, the desperate notes. Peel your own image from the mirror. Sit, feast on your life. Let his words continue to light the world.
Dis-moi d'où ça fait mal la peine, mais oui, ça vrai. Dis-moi d'où ça touche chez moi, mais oui, ça vrai. Dis-moi d'où ça peine de moi, mais oui, ça vrai. c'est ma mari actuellement, y'a pas qu'à faire l'amour pour rien. Moi je vais nous n'aguasumer, moi je vais nous tout déchouer. Moi maintenant on la caille à moi, moi pas boire, moi pas manger. Moi maintenant on a un magasin, pour pas aux autres besoins. Ou ka di ma ka travail, ou ka point bache, ou ka aller. Everybody, si moi dou ça fait mal la peine, mais oui, ça vrai. Si moi dou ça touche chez moi, mais oui, ça vrai. Si moi dou ça mène chez moi, mais oui, ça vrai. Si ma maille actuellement, yo pa ka fait l'amour pour rien. Moi je nous tout déchouer, moi je nous en maxe. Moi maintenant la caille, moi, moi pas boire, moi pas manger. Moi maintenant on a un magasin, pour pas sauter besoin. Ou qu'a dit ma carte travail, ou qu'a point passé, ou qu'a allé. Mais oui, ça boue. Mais oui, ça boue. C'est ma maille actuellement, yo pas qu'à faire l'amour pour. Ça c'est la vérité, vous savez. C'est ma maille actuellement, c'est pas de l'argent, pas ni l'amour, papa. Ah, avec ça mauvais, hein. Mais oui, ça vrai. C'est ma maille actuellement, yo pas qu'à faire l'amour pour rien. Moi je vais nous n'aguasumer, moi je vais nous tout déchouer. Moi maintenant bon caille à moi, moi pas boire, moi pas manger. Moi maintenant on a un magasin, pour pas nécessité. Ou qu'a dit ma carte travail, ou qu'a point bâché, ou qu'a.
Thank you. To every place we play. And so Derek was present. If we don't sing that song, you must sing that song first for him before you leave. And as I'm singing that song, I'm feeling everything inside of me is moving because this gentleman was my pal. This gentleman was my pal. And I miss him dearly.
I'm thinking of Walter de la Mare's Farewell, a poem he cherished, and hearing these lines in the grit of his voice with the waves joining the recitation. How will fare the world whose wonder was the very proof of me? It's a question for us, we the bewildered, we the ones left behind. Derek Walcott left us a universe he built with sedimental, not sentimental, accretion, the great mythology he remade out of our Byzantine lands and lives. He believed so very deeply in us. He really believed in the Caribbean, which he taught us is a synonym for the world. He believed in poetry. Derek said to me once, the presence of that landscape or seascape inside you is superior to whatever language you speak. It is stronger than the language you speak. You can't separate the rhythm of Mali from the hills of Jamaica, and you don't need the Mali because the hills are there. But ultimately, they are only manifestations of praise. He was and is a school in which we could train and study and be assessed in the craft, elemental and plural as a school of fish who collect now translucent into his face, then are startled by me and scatter, and he is gone again. Everybody has a Walcott story. I have too many to tell. After a reading he gave in London over a decade ago, his partner, Sigrid Nama, said to me, "You just keep on turning up like a bad penny." And bad penny me was somehow welcomed into their fold. I am still floored by his generosity, his genius sonority. Every day I think of the line, "Christ, my craft, and the long time it is taking." Have I disappointed you? Have I failed you? The past tense is painful. For years now, I have been turning over the last words of his Nobel lecture like a shell in my hands, cherishing our insignificance. What does that mean? Insignificant, unimportant, small in size, without meaning, answering to no purpose. Those deemed insignificant, like us, are without meaning that others can understand, answering to no purpose but our own. We have a vision, a power beyond our own comprehension in our mass of blessed obscurity. Like the fly, we small ones see what others cannot. We, the bastards of history, the strangers, the outsiders, the small ones, los nadies, les dames de la terre. He, more than anyone else, shows us the infinite in the infinitesimal. Even in your stillness, you are moving still.
Auction time, auction time. Ladies and gentlemen, it's auction time. Foreign investors, ladies and gentlemen, auction time. I am your licensed auctioneer. Paradise for sale. 238 square miles, as is, where is. They love it so much, they fought over it. Seven times British, seven times French. Auction time, ladies and gentlemen, it's auction time. Pitons for sale, view to die for. Buy one, get one free. Do I have $11,000? Do I have $12,000? $12,000, $12,500. Do I have $15,000, $16,000? Do I have $17,000, $18,000? Going once, $18,000, going twice, gone. Sold, sold, sold! to the millionaire over yonder to build a mega resort at the foothills of the World Heritage Site. Auction time! Auction time! Ladies and gentlemen, it's auction time. Another fine day for an auction. That's what's up for grab. White sandy beach, beachfront, bargain hunt. Paradise for sale. All its tropical splendor, flora and fauna. Simply beautiful. Paradise for sale. Sell, sell, sell. Do I have $12,000? Do I have $30,000? No, going once, going twice. Do I have $50,000? $50,000, $50,000, $55,000. Do I have $50,000 going once, going twice? Gone. Sold, sold, sold. To the big belly Jamaican man with the white straw hat, with white short pants, flowered shirt, wearing sandals over there. Another luxury hotel? Passports for sale, airports for sale, seaports for sale, airspace for sale? Auction time, auction time! Ladies and gentlemen, it's auction time. Sale, sale, sale. Lands in the south for sale. Going cheap, cheap, cheap. For lease or for sale? Do I have $1 per acre? Do I have $1 per acre? Do I have $1 for acre? Going once, $1 for acre, going twice, going, going, gone. Sold, sold, sold! Sold, sold, sold to the Chinese man over there in Beijing for integrated resort. Notice, trespassers will be violated by Fan Chu. Passports for sale, airports for sale, seaports for sale, airspace for sale. Auction time, auction time. Ladies and gentlemen, it's auction time. Maria Island for sale, Rat Island for sale, Fodor Heritage Park for sale, Pigeon Island National Park for sale, National Landmark, sold, sold, sold to Dolphin Park. Frigate Island, sold, sold, sold to the foreign investor online. Passports for sale, airports for sale, seaports for sale. Auction time! Auction time! Ladies and gentlemen, it's auction time. Potential World Heritage Site for sale. World's only driving volcano for sale. Crownlands for sale, woodlands for sale, seabed for sale, coral reef for sale, Queen's Chain for sale, Black Bay lands, sold, sold, sold! To the foreign investor on Skype. Passports for sale, airports for sale, seaports for sale, airspace for sale. Auction time, auction time. Ladies and gentlemen, it's auction time. JQ Charles for sale. Super J, sold, sold, sold to Massey Stores. Glass, going, going, Bridge Street branch gone. Bank of St. Lucia International, all the bank you need, sold, sold, sold. One independence celebration morning, we will wake up, flags waving, I am Lucian, I am Lucia. And suddenly realize 238 square miles on the auction block. Going once, going twice, going, 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 sold, sold, sold to the cheapest foreign bidder online. Thank you very much. Good night.
You prepare for one sorrow, but another comes. It is not like the weather. You cannot brace yourself. The unreadiness is all. Your companion, the woman, the friend next to you, the child at your side, and the dog. We tremble for them. We look seaward and muse it will rain. We shall get ready for rain. You do not connect the sunlight, altering the darkening oleanders in the sea garden. The gold going out of the palms, you do not connect this, the fleck of the drizzle on your flesh, with the dog's whimper. The thunder doesn't frighten. The readiness is all. What follows at your feet is trying to tell you. The silence is all. It is deeper than the readiness. It is sea deep, earth deep, love deep. The silence is stronger than thunder. We are stricken dumb and deep as the animals who never utter love as we do, except it becomes unutterable and must be said in a whimper, in tears, in the drizzle that comes to our eyes, not uttering the loved thing's name. The silence of the dead, the silence of the deepest buried love is the one silence. And whether we bear it for beast, for child, for woman, or friend, it is the one love. It is the same, and it is blessed, deepest by loss. It is blessed. It is blessed.
Mama Heladi, why? Di why encore? Why? Di why do? Why? Di why toujours?
Why?
For the crackle and hiss of the word August. Like a low bonfire on a beach. For the wriggling of white masts in the marina on a Wednesday after work, I would return. I would come back and forget the niggling complaints of what the island lacks, how it is without the certainties of cities. Mama Eladi, why?
Why?
For a fisherman walking back to this village with his jigging rod and a good catch that blazes like rainbows when he shows it to you. For the ember that goes out suddenly like a match when the day and all that it brought is finished. For the lights on the piers, and for the first star, for whom my love of the island has never diminished, but will burn steadily when I am gone, wherever you are. And for the lion's silhouette of Pigeon Island, and your cat that presumes the posture of a sphinx, and for the long, empty sand of your absence. Mama Eladi, why? Di why your core?
the wire call, my lady, why? Thank you.
Sir Derek Walcott, January 23rd, 1930 to March 17th, 2017. May his soul rest in peace. Odd Job, a Bull Terrier, by Derek Walcott.
One sorrow, but another comes. It is not like the weather.
You cannot brace yourself. The unreadiness is all.
Your companion, the woman. The woman. The child at your side and the
dog. We tremble for them. Look seaward and muse.
It will rain.
We shall get ready for rain.
We do not connect.
The sunlight altering. The darkening oleanders in the sea garden. The gold going out of the palm.
You do not connect this.
The fleck of the drizzle on your flesh. With the dog's wing. The thunder. Does it frighten? The readiness is all. What follows at your feet
is trying to tell you the silence is all. It is deeper than the readiness.
The sea deep, earth deep, love deep. Seekings, half my friends are dead. I won't make a new one, said Oof. No, give me them back as they were instead. With faults and all, I cried.
Tonight I can snatch their talk from the faint serfs drone through the canes, but I cannot walk.
On moonlit leaves of ocean, down that white road alone, or floating with that dreaming motion.
Of ours leaving Earth's load, O Earth, the number of friends you keep exceeds those left to be loved.
The sea canes by the cliff flash green and silver. They were the seraph lances of my faith, but out of what is lost grows something stronger.
That has the rational radiance of stone.
Enjoying moonlight further than despair.
Strong as the wind that through dividing came, bring those we love before us as we go. With faults and all, not nobler, yet there.
Love after love.
The time will come when, with the lesson you will greet yourself arriving at your own door, in your own mirror, and each will smile at the other's welcome, and say, see here.
Sir Derek Walcott, January 23rd, 1930 to March 17th, 2017. May his soul rest in peace.
Shining like the risen sun of his treasured motherland. Like a giant strong and tall with a literary plan. I come to sing in honor of Derek. I come to sing because I feel proud. I come to recognize all his merits. I come to raise him high like a cloud. I am deeply satisfied we didn't wait until he died to give the honor he's due. But if you do not know this, why we tell him so, this was the greatest living writer in this world today. Of culture by Bush and Malawi. Sunrise in the sky. Derek Alton Walcott must win that Nobel Prize. The gun is all aflame. There it is. son of this Lucian man, the brightest burning flame, an extraordinary man, for the bride and queen.
From a very tender age, he displayed his genius. Every time he wrote a page, it glistened like golden dust. I hear some say it's as good as Shakespeare. I hear some say it's better by far. Spread would only write in English. He writes in English and in patois. Tija and his brothers and all the classic others like Sia Dofe are all his plays. The Joker of Seville up to now, we love it still though he wrote that since his early days. The greatest living writer in this world today, crowned the king of culture by Bourdieu and Malleway. Shout it from the hilltops and write it in the sky. Derek Alton Walcott must get that Nobel Prize. He was born for the Hall of Fame, raised for the wide acclaim. A son of this Lucian land, the brightest burning flame, an extraordinary man of honor, pride and fame. I am not afraid to say some of us are hypocrites. In the bookstores every day, spending cash on endless pit. We should invest in his books and poetry to read about our very own lives. They should show all his plays on TV instead of this Yankee jive. The man is such a test when he calls the Peter's breast. You can see the hotel plan is like rape. If we let our young ones read his books, may plant a seed and their minds will be a rich landscape. Greatest living writer in this world today, crowned the king of culture by Bourdieu and Malleway. Shout it from the hilltops and write it in the sky. Derek Alton Walcott must get that Nobel Prize. He was born for the Hall of Fame, raised for the wide acclaimed. A son of this Lucian land, an extraordinary man. Never should the words be said, our youth have gone astray. Our heroes, live or dead, they have always shown the way. Our list of heroes is lengthy, I can never mention them all. Other countries watch us with envy, our paragons stand so tall. Dan Lee, Alexander and Dunstan, Sentiment and the Lewis brothers are just a few. Patrick Webster and Royal J, the lecturer of Bud Walcott, was the meat in the stew. The latest human writer in this world today, crowned the king of culture by Bourdieu and Malleway. Shout it on the hilltops and write it in the sky. Derek Alton Walcott, he got that Nobel Prize. He's born for the Hall of Fame, raised for the wide acclaim. This Lucian land, an extraordinary man, for honor, pride and fame. Yeah, thank you. For those lyrics we said, he was born for the Hall of Fame, but he also said that Derek Alton Walcott must get that Nobel Prize because the song, penned by Ron Sion, music by myself, was written more than a year before Derek Walton was awarded the Nobel Prize.
So it was a prediction which came true for St. Lucia. I thank you very much, and may his soul rest in peace.
Hello, I'm Nigel St. Hill. I was born on 17 Chaussee Road about 74 years ago. I grew up with Derek, Roddy, and my mother, Pamela, and my grandmother, Alex Walcott. On behalf of Sigrid, the whole Walcott family, nephews, nieces, cousins, et cetera, and grandchildren, I'd like to thank the following people. I have to read, so give me a break. Her Excellency, Dame Pearlette Louisy, the Governor General of St. Lucia, Senator, the Honorable Fortuna Belrose, Minister in the Ministry of Local Government and Culture. Other ministers, performers, Cultural Development Foundation, and the people of St. Lucia. Thank you very much for a wonderful evening.
In this world today, with a change of heart could all go away. He said the old and the weak, he said the sick and the poor, with a change of heart their problems could be right out of the door. Those who have not, the bottom is top. Open up our hearts and let us give more, give more. We need to change our hearts. We need to change our hearts. Cause if we wanna see a better world today, we need to change our hearts. Change our hearts. We need to change our hearts. Cause if we wanna see a better world today, we need to change our hearts.
The inspiration of a Derek and a man like Kendall, a man say like boats have a thing. The inspiration of a Derek and a man like Kendall, a man say like a boats have a thing. The inspiration of a Derek and a man like Kendall, a man say like a boats have a thing. Oh, Mr. Man, write poetry with the rhythm. Read poetry with the rhythm. Play poetry with the rhythm. Dance poetry with the rhythm. Because the rhythm of the word and the power of the word and the rhythm of the word have a thing. You know the rhythm of the word and the power of the word and the rhythm of the word have a thing. You know the rhythm of the word and the power of the word and the rhythm of the word have a thing. You know the rhythm of the word and the power of the word and the rhythm of the word have a thing. Oh, Mr. Man, write poetry with the rhythm.
Something stirred within me as his raspy voice fondled my ear with verse as familiar as the Old Testament, a testament to our mentors and beret-donned intellectuals standing like liars. And as John before Christ, wafting away when frail lip and wasted body insufflated the printed page, kindling a pride coursing through my veins, rending me from slumber's embrace in search of nib and virgin page, to pen how, on a crisp January night, with cherished sun and literary sojourners, we tickled our colonial past.
We shall rise again. One more time, we will rise again. We will rise, and we shall rise today. And it goes like this, goes. The love within our heart is all we need to stand. Love really conquers all, so we can't remain apart. I know, sometimes we just don't get along. But still, we all must live as one. The time is now. We all must love each other. Somewhere. together. Yeah! Let me be the shoulder you will lean upon. We can go wrong, we shall rise again. We will rise again, no matter what we've been through.